In Chapter 7, we begin to talk about our endocrine system, and in this video specifically, we will be talking about our hyperthyroid agents. So the main categories that we'll be discussing in this video are going to be our thiamides, and then two different types of iodine. We have our radioactive iodine and our non-radioactive iodine. So our thiamides can be broken down into two different drugs. We have our methimazole, and the brand for that is tapazole. And then we also have our propylthiouracil, which is commonly just abbreviated as PTU. And then our two different types of iodine, as previously mentioned, are our radioactive iodine, commonly referred to as radioiodine, and then our non-radioactive iodine, commonly referred to as Lugol's solution. So our first question is, which medication is the safest for administration and does not lead to tolerance? Is that A, our thiamide methimazole, brand tapazole, B, thiamide propylthiouracil, PTU, C, radioactive iodine, radioiodine, or D, non-radioactive iodine, commonly referred to as Lugol's solution? That's going to be A, our methimazole. It's going to be our safest option that does not lead to tolerance. So B, our propylthiouracil, and C, our radioactive iodine, are going to be the two options on this list that are going to have the highest side effect profile. So B, propylthiouracil, or PTU, has a black box warning for some hepatotoxicity. And C, our radioactive iodine, isn't really going to be the safest option either because it can lead to thyroid destruction, or essentially that's its main role, is thyroid destruction. So that can lead to some serious consequences as well. While D is a safer route, our non-radioactive iodine is a safer route than our PTU or radioactive iodine, it can lead to tolerance. So that's why D is incorrect in this question. Our next question is going to relate to PTU, or propylthiouracil, and this question states, which of the following medications is administered several times per day for maintenance therapy and is associated with hepatotoxicity? So when talking about maintenance therapy, there are two medications on this list that we do not use for maintenance, and that's going to be both of our iodines, our radioactive iodine and our non-radioactive iodine. So our maintenance therapy medications are going to be limited to our methimazole or our propylthiouracil. And when it comes to maintenance, our methimazole is going to be used just once a day, and PTU, or propylthiouracil, is going to be used 3 times a day. And it does have that black box warning for hepatotoxicity as well. The next question here is going to be relating our radioactive iodine, and that question is, which medication destroys the thyroid gland and can lead to overcorrection of hyperthyroidism? And that's going to be C, our radioactive iodine. So it's going to work to specifically destroy the thyroid gland. And there's no specific known amount that it's going to destroy until the patient comes back for a checkup. And the medication, the radioactive iodine, might destroy too much of the thyroid gland. And that could lead to a patient becoming hypothyroid and needing to take synthetic thyroid to correct for that long term. So that would be the correct answer in this case. Our methimazole and propylthiouracil are going to work to inhibit our thyroid hormone formation, and our non-radioactive iodine is going to work as a negative feedback on the formation of our thyroid hormones. And the last question that we have here is going to discuss the implications that non-radioactive iodine has in hyperthyroidism. And that question is, which medication is administered in drops and is used as an adjunct therapy for hyperthyroidism? So A and B, our methimazole and our propylthiouracil, are both tablets, and they're mainstay therapies for patients that have hyperthyroidism. C, our radioactive iodine, comes in either a capsule or liquid formula, and that is also going to be a mainstay therapy for patients with hyperthyroidism. D, our non-radioactive iodine, is going to be a solution that is administered in drops. However, this is going to be an adjunct therapy for patients with hyperthyroidism. Commonly, it's used in the leading up to before a patient has their thyroid gland removed for surgery. That's typically when this medication is used.